Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the session of the economic impact of a mega sport event, a case study of Asian Games 2018. And now we would like to welcome the chair, Ibu Amalia Adiningar Widyasanti. Silakan, Ibu.
Yeah, thank you very much, Ibu. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the International Economic Association Online World Congress. And then we are now here in the session of the economic impact of a mega sport event, a case study of ASEAN Games 2018. For your information, that most of the papers that will be presented in this session, it is actually based on the study that was undertaken by Ministry of National Development Planning or Bappenas with in collaboration with the University of Indonesia. Because at that time we are going to know what is actually the economic impact by having a mega sport event, which is Asian Games 2018. The success of ASEAN Games in 2018 also can be impacted to the economy of Indonesia, especially the economy where the sport event was located. Mainly in DKI Jakarta and also in South Sumatra, which is held in Palembang and Jakabaring. For this session, we will have speakers for paper one. We have four papers with several speakers. We have paper one titled Long-Term Effect of Mega Event on Host Country's Tourism, Evidence from the Jakarta Palembang 2018 Asian Games. Paper two, the title is Estimating Economic Impact of a Major Sport Event, a Case Study of the 18th Asian Games. And paper three, the title is Bank Credit Development, a Study of Macroprudential Effect. And paper four is special capital roles in maintaining investment sustainability in Lumajang Regency. For your information, that paper three and paper four is actually not really related to the mega sport event, but this will be actually included in the presentation of the session. Without further ado, I would like to invite Pak Revindo. He will present a long-term effect of mega event on host country's tourism, evidence from the Jakarta Palembang 2018 Asian Games. Pak Revindo is actually the lecturer from the University of Indonesia. And Pak Revindo is actually the theme of the economic impact of Asian Games, where the study was undertaken in 2018. With that, I would like to offer the floor to Pak Revindo. Pak Revindo, I think you're still muted.
Yeah, thank you, Bu Winnie, for the opportunity. Good afternoon, everyone. Can you hear me clear now? And yeah, can yes. You also see my slide? Yeah. Can you also yeah. see my slide clear now?
It is very clear, Pak.
Okay, so allow me in the next 10 or 12 minutes to just share my research, especially actually our research on the Asian Games. While the second paper, Pak Firman will talk about the impact, I will talk about something more specific or more micro level. So I just put the title Expenditure and Behavioral Intention of the Participant and Spectators. So it's written by several authors, including Bu Winnie herself and also other team members. Okay, so the outline of my presentation just resembles the general research paper. I will start with brief introduction and brief literature and discuss briefly the method and also discuss the result and some conclusion. So why is it important? Why we need to talk about this? The first reason is that the 18 Asian Games was the biggest in the history of Asian Games, larger than previous similar events. especially in terms of the competing athletes. It attracted more than 11,000 athletes. And it attracted almost 90,000 spectators coming to Indonesia specifically to attend the event. It's not just tourism, they wanted to attend the events. And also it attracted more than 10,000 journalists, not only from Asia, but beyond the Asia. So this is why is it important. And then what's the research problem? Let's define it. First is that the event, the mega sport event, required a large sum of public budget, state budget. So it has to be counterbalanced with the economic impact generated by the spending, of course. And then apart from the direct economic impact from the tourist spending, there's also indirect and intangible effect like the image of Indonesia. It's very important. So we have to capture that. And also, there's less studies on sport event because sport event is part of sport tourism and sport tourism is a part of tourism research area. Sport event is very difficult because it's short time to collect the data. So it's less studies than other issues. And then by that, we define our objective is that we want to know the behavior of the participant and spectators in terms of their determinants, the total spending, the determinants, the spending composition, how they evaluate Indonesia as the host country, and whether they would like to revisit Indonesia beyond the event, and also whether they would like to tell good stories about Indonesia beyond the event. So a brief literature, I think most of the participants in this Zoom know better than I do, but just to review a little bit. So sport tourism is defined as a travel activity to compete in sport event. To compete means as an athlete itself, to observe as a spectator, and also as an organizing committee. Sport tourism expenditure can be classified into the organizational expenditure, organizational expenditure by the committee, the delegation, or the participant from the athletes and officials, and also from the spectators. Also, the spending is influenced by socio-demographic characteristics. And also, Mueller found that the economic impact can be analyzed in three phases. Prior to the event, you know, the committee and the host government already spent some money for construction and or venue preparation. During the event, the participant and the spectator spend their money, and beyond the event, they may coming back to the host country, or they purchase the product from the host country through online shopping. So we need a conceptual framework because behavior is very important, but we need a framework to analyze their behavior. So first is the expectation. Normally the visitors or the participants, when they want to go to a country, they have expectation. They already have something in mind about Indonesia. Indonesia is like this and like that, right? So it's affected by their past experience, the information that they receive, whether they receive good or bad information about the host country, and also their socioeconomic and cultural background. And then they arrive in Indonesia, the host country. They decide how many days they stay, they spend their money and for different purposes, and also maybe they decide to go to several places other than the venues. And then after the event, what they do, they will try to evaluate whether they are satisfied or not with the host country. They will decide whether the host country is doing well, and they will decide whether the host country has a specific value to offer. And then in the long term, the customer loyalty or the tourist loyalty will define the economic impact, whether they want to revisit the host country. They want to spread good stories about the host country, and they will purchase a product from the host country through online shopping. So this is the respondent composition. We built a quite big team, consisted of 40 enumerators doing face-to-face survey in Jakarta and Palembang. And we managed together 2,600 total respondents. They are from different categories of respondents, including athletes, country officials, journalists, visitors, organizing committee, sport federation, and also the businesses. So it's as you can see, the origin of the respondents, international respondents, are coming not only from Asia, but beyond Asia. from outside Asia. Okay, now let's go to the result. I will not bother you with those introduction. Let's go to the result. This is quite interesting. The average spending, the female spending spend more. Those in Palembang spend more than in Jakarta. Those coming from beyond ASEAN, they spend more. And those who have never to Indonesia before, they spend more than those who have been to Indonesia at least once. And those who have never to international sport event before, they also spend more than their than otherwise. In terms of international respondents, apart from the accommodation spending should not be included because the accommodation for the athletes is hosted by the host country, right? In athlete village. So apart from accommodation and food, the international journalists spend more than other categories. In terms of age group, those aged 30 to 40 spend more money than other age group. And in terms of length of stay, it's interesting because those who focus to stay during the event spend more than others. And now the spending composition. Again, this not includes the accommodation and food because it's not comparable, because the athlete and official are hosted by the host country. So we see that international spectators and international journalists and also international athletes, what they do, they didn't spend a lot of money during the event, but they decide to spend the money at the last day of their stay in host country or in Indonesia. So they allocated a certain amount of money. So for example, they say, okay, I will spend $2,000, but I will not spend it now. I will wait until the last day and I will decide what I would like to buy. That's why the largest portion is the dark blue. They allocated but unspecified yet. But for the committee, the officials, and the athletes, they like to spend a lot of money for souvenir gifts and memorabilia. So this is opportunities. And the next item that is also important for them is food and beverages. They like to try some restaurants in the city that they compete. And then the evaluation of the event. We asked them 7 categories, and this is the result. On the sport facilities and venues, they were quite happy, except for the official Olympic Committee of Asia. Why? Because they're demanding. They wanted something better. They always criticize the venues. That's normal. The transportation and traffic management improvement could be made, especially for international journalists and spectators. They didn't like the arrangement. They like to be mobile. On food and accommodation, the athletes and official would like food variation and larger room size. On the security and safety, mostly gave good and excellent. So how we interpret this? Because simply I said, I think this is because Indonesia as a host country exceeded the expectation. It's not, I don't know whether this is because we are above the standard or just we exceeded their expectation, because maybe prior to their arrival in Indonesia, they received bad news about Indonesia. But when they arrived in the event, they said, it's not that bad. This is very important for post-COVID events, because post-COVID events, they will put more emphasis on health and safety. On scheduling, of course, official and spectators would like to be less tight schedule. And also on the information provision, they demand more information desk or leaflet everywhere. And the last one is very important on telecommunication and internet services. We need to improve that, not simply because we did bad, but because they tend to compare the service with their own country. And with the lack of reference, when you arrive to strange country, how the most important thing before you decide to shop
is yes,
to,
that one
like the, to look for yes, the online the reviews from online sources, whether the shop are trusted or not. And finally, the long-term economic impact. This is also interesting because
1 minute left, Pak Rekindo. Yes, sorry for that.
70% respondent would like to return to Indonesia. 95% are going to tell good stories about Indonesia. And 89% of country officials would like to recommend Indonesia as future host for other events. Conclusion, we did well, but there's an improvement needed because we didn't fully capitalize the potential sales of the merchandises, and we late to realize the potential economic impact of local spectators. Only the second week, we held the festivals, inviting the domestic residents, and we missed the momentum to revitalize the domestic sport competition. So we expected that after the event, it should spark the domestic competition, but we didn't capitalize it. And then future studies, I suggest future studies look at the impact of COVID on the sport event, because there's something going to change, something must be changed, and behavioral of local domestic spectators in international sport event has been undermined. And also we need a similar study for other sport event, especially the single event such as Borobudur Marathon. I think I will stop there, Ibu Winnie. Thank you for the time. I look forward for discussion.
Thank you very much, Pak Revindo, for the presentation, a comprehensive presentation. And I would say that what you just now conclude, that the ASEAN Games really give a positive impact to the Indonesian economy, especially to the economy of DKI Jakarta and Palembang or South Sumatra. And also the spending actually is the key that can create the positive impact to the economy. And spending can be generated from athletes or from participants, and also from other attendees of the mega sport event. So with that, I would like to open the floor for discussion. I would like to invite if there is any questions or comments on what that have been presented by Pak Revindo. You can post the questions to the chat room. There is like one question already posted by Revindo. The question is that I'm curious in the long-term effect of those events. Will there be any literature on that for the long-term effect of the event?
Yeah, thank you, Bu Winnie. I will just answer it directly. So before we answer that question, we have to define first what you mean by long-term effect, right? So in our study, we define our long-term effect as, especially in my paper, for the multiplier effect, Pak Firman will explain it later, right? So the multiplier effect that is not happening at one time, but also several rounds beyond the event, Pak Firman will discuss it. But in terms of tourist behavior, in our study, we define the long-term effect as whether they will revisit Indonesia in the future, not to visit the event, but as a tourist. And our study said reported that more than 70% would like, 70 to 80% would like to revisit Indonesia. And of course, we were afraid that those answers was only lip service, right? So we asked further question. Did you decide yet the destination in Indonesia, just to test whether they're serious about their intention? And most of them can mention some specific places in Indonesia. They said, I'm going to Labuan Bajo, I'm going to this and that. Okay, they are quite serious about that. So that's the long-term impact. The second long-term impact that we define in our study is, are they going to tell good stories? They recommend Indonesia to their respective audience, to their family and colleagues. 95% said yes. They will definitely ask their colleague and families to visit Indonesia. And also the officials and International Sport Federation, they plan to use Indonesia as training places. For example, if they have to compete in Singapore or in Australia, maybe they train before the event in Indonesia. And also they are willing to recommend Indonesia as the host for future events. That's how we define long-term effect. For the economic multiplier effect, maybe the second speaker can answer that better.
Yeah. Thank you, Pak Revindo. There is like another three question, but the one question is, I think it is very much related to Pak Firman's presentation later on. So I will just pick two questions that can be answered by Pak Revindo. The first one is questions from Ibu Dewi Sartika Siagian. how to alleviate the social desirability bias from the respondents in the research. And they said that expenditure and behavioral intention. And the second one, will Pak Revindo and team have any interest to make similar studies for FIBA Asian Cup 2021 because of this COVID situation? I'll give the floor to you, Pak Revindo, for the two questions.
They're tough questions, but it's good for discussion. Give me second thought about the study. Of course, as a researcher, we have to think for other possibilities. I will start to ask about from the question answer the question from Ibu Dewi, right?
Yeah.
So we have to admit that you know, the potential bias can be there because we were conducting face-to-face interview, and then you know, some of them refused to participate. So there's possibility that those who participate in the event are those who are you know, very happy or very enthusiastic, or they are unhappy, very unhappy. So let's say they complain a lot about some facilities, and they, when there's someone interview them, they say, "Oh, okay, I would like to report the thing that I don't like." Or those who are very happy, "Yeah, this is very good." So yes, the bell curve, possibly some population in the middle of the bell curve were not captured on the survey, because this is random but not fully random, right? But this is much better than the online survey. This is not online survey. The online survey is worse in terms of bias. So that's my answer. Yes, there's potential bias. We have to admit that. And other question, FIBA Asian Cup 2021. Yes, of course, we are happy to do that. For your information, we already submitted proposal for the study on the Borobudur Marathon prior to the pandemic, because we want to make a larger impact to local communities. But due to the pandemic, it has to be postponed. And we have also other sport event coming up. We have World Cup under 20, right? The football World Cup.
And also MotoGP, Pak.
MotoGP, yes. And also, ini Bu, what was that? The National Olympic, the PON.
Yeah, PON.
Yeah, so we really need a comprehensive study in order to maximize the benefit for local population.
Thank you, Pak Revindo. I think I will close the session for question to Pak Revindo.
But feel free to email me or to
exactly
reach me, yes, later on.
Yes, if the participants would like to raise another questions or comments to Pak Revindo, please feel free to reach Pak Revindo by email. Thank you, Pak Revindo, anyway, for the interesting presentations and discussion. I would like to go to a second paper. Second paper is titled Estimating Economic Impact of a Major Sport Event, a Case Study of the 18 Asian Games. And then the paper will be presented by Pak Muhammad Firman Hidayat. He is currently working for Ministry of National Development Planning, Bappenas, at Directorate of Macro Planning and Statistic Analysis. And he will be soon promoted as a special advisor to the Minister of to the Coordinating Minister of Maritime Affairs and Investment. Now the floor is yours, Pak Firman. And you will have only you will have 10 minutes for presentation, Pak Firman.
Okay. Thank you.
Floor to you. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you, Guini, for the kind introductions. Ladies and gentlemen, today I will be presenting our paper. So this is the paper that is written by me and then also Berta and also Ibu Guini. So the title of the paper is Estimating Economic Impact of a Major Sport Event, a Case Study of the 18 Asian Games. So for the introductions, I think this is already explained by Pak Revindo. So in 2018, we held 18 Asian Games. That was deemed a success by many people, which it is held. It was held in two cities, Jakarta and Palembang, and brought more than 70,000 athletes and officials, right? And then the spectators is more than 70,000, and more than 70,000 of them are from abroad. So as the host country, government of Indonesia made huge investment by building and accelerating the completions, not only supporting revenues, but also major infrastructures. And the allocation for operational expenditures also amounted more than 5 trillion rupiah. So the question is it worth it, right, to have this such a big event held in Indonesia, right? So the question is for this study, we try to answer the question whether the success is justifiable in terms of economic impact, considering the corresponding investment that already put by the government of Indonesia. So if we look at various study have applied different methods to assess the economic impact of a major sports event, so which include input-output modeling, CGI modeling, and some of them also use econometric modeling. So I think the most popular one is input-output modeling. So there are you can see there are some study here, Humphries and Plumber, 1995. They measure the short-term impact of Olympics in Atlanta, Kim et al., Zhang et al. They all use input-output model. So but although it's common, but the input-output model has some weaknesses and considered as the old approach to assess the economic impact of sport event. So I think the one that gained popularity is the CGI approach. I think Madden used this approach to measure the impact of Sydney Olympic. There are also papers from Blake and Lee et al., the latest ones. They measured the impact of Beijing Olympic in 2008.
Pak Firman, are you there?
Oh, sorry, I mute myself.
Yeah, okay.
So the contribution of study, we add the application of CGI modeling, assessing the economic impact of sports event, in this case, the 18 Asian Games. So we will use a multi-regional CGI model. We measure the impact of at the national and also provincial level, Jakarta and South Sumatra and West Java that hosted the games. We also cover three phases, pre-event, during the event, and also post-event. So basically, to our knowledge, this is the first study that extensively and rigorously estimates the economic of sports event in Indonesia. So we hope that this study can be used as reference for the government in organizing similar events after Asian Games. So I will explain a little bit about the framework. So as I mentioned, the study covered three phases, the pre-event, the event, and the post-event. So the pre-event, we cover the operation of the games of over 3 years, the preparations of the games. And we also measure the construction impact of the games, including the building of sporting venue, accommodation for participants, and also the necessary upgrading of transport infrastructures. During the event, so basically we measure the direct impact of the operation of the game. It's related to the games visitor expenditures. So the overseas visitors expenditures, the spectators, and we also measure the operational expenditure that was done by Inascog at that time. So for the post-event, we try to measure the induced tourism expenditures. We make a small, simple forecast, actually, the impact of Asian Games to the tourists in the post-event, and then we try to calculate the what economic impact. So this direct impact will add additional spending to the economy, and then it will increase economic growth and employment. This is basically the framework that we use. So I think the most part of the study is measuring the direct expenditure or impact, and luckily in the government, from the government can get many access to the data that we need to measure the direct expenditure or impact. So we have three different direct expenditure: the games visitor expenditure, the operational expenditure of the games, and the construction expenditure of the games. This is basically that gonna be the shocks in the simulations of the CGI model. So direct expenditure, there are construction expenditure, operational expenditure, and games visitor expenditure. For the construction, basically we collect the data from the government, how much they spend for government for public road, for example, for sports venue, athlete village, and toll road that support the Asian Games. And then for the operational expenditures, basically we collect this data from INASGOG. So this is start from athlete preparation, broadcasting, promotions, and other stuff. For the game visitor expenditures, we try to calculate the spending by athlete, official, media, and we divide it by whether they are foreigners or they are domestic or local visitors. And then we group the spending into different sectors, such as accommodation, food and beverage, and others. This is how we measure the game's visitor expenditures. Basically, we collect the number of visitors, number of foreigners. We differentiate between athletes, official, and media because we think that the spending will gonna be different. And we also differentiate between local and foreigner. And then we measure the length of stay and then average spending per day by sectors. And we will get, I will show you here. Oh, sorry. I will show you later on in the next slide. So for the model itself, we use Indotherm model. So we use what we call Indotherm CGU model. So Indotherm is a dynamic. So it's we can run, since we cover three different phases, from before 2018, 2018, and after 2018. So because we use that model, we can able to apply that. And then this model is also a bottom-up model, so based on provinces. So we can give a different shock into different provinces. So in this case, we give a shock to Jakarta provinces and also South Sumatra provinces. So basically, this is the illustrations of simulation shock in the CG model. So for the construction, we give the shock to investment and government expenditure for construction sector. And then for operational expenditure, it's gonna be government expenditure for different sectors. And game visitor expenditure is divided into foreigner and local. Foreigner is gonna be export, local is gonna be household. And this is the calculation, how we get the game visitor expenditure. So we have this the number of visitors, we divide it into different types of visitors. And then we can calculate the total game visitor expenditure by sectors. And this is going to be the shock to CGU model. And this is by type of visitors. So the different type of visitors will have a different types of spending. So this is the construction investment and even operational cost. Basically, this is the data we collect from the government. So we know for sure that how much the government spend for event operational cost, and then how much the government spend for the construction investments. So the total for event operational cost is 7.8 trillion, and the construction investment is 29.1 trillion. And we know the locations of this investment, whether it's in Jakarta or in South Sumatra. This is the estimation, the total estimations of direct impact we're gonna put in the CGU model as the shock. So we put that direct impact in the model, and then we can measure the macroeconomic impact in Jakarta and also in South Sumatra and also national. So basically, this is the result for Jakarta. You can see that pre-event, the increase in GDP growth will came from real investment, because most of the spending before the event is comes from the construction spending. So you can see the red line, the real investment increased by a lot. The increase in real household is supported, is due to the increase in overall GDP. And then during the event, the biggest increase, actually, we can see increase in real government. This is due to the operational expenditure to the games. And you can see also the export volume during the 2018 is increasing because of the visitor games expenditure and also household in 2018. This is a sectoral impact in Jakarta. You can see because of the Asian Games, I think the most benefited sector is the art and entertainment. This is basically related to tourism because many people come from foreign, from abroad, and then also the local domestics, they not only come to the event, but they also come to visit the tourism places. So it will increase the art and entertainment sectors. Benefited sector is utilities and construction. Basically, this is due to the construction investment done by the government to support the operational of the events. And we can see what interesting, there's also increase in sports equipment sectors. We found, I think, based on the result of survey by Pak Revindo, many athletes spend their stipend to buy sports equipment here in Jakarta. I think the same result we had in South Sumatra, it gives positive impact in overall GDP. And then before the event, the impact comes from the investment. And then during the event, it comes from the real government due to the operational expenditure and also from the visitor expenditure. And this is the same, the sector impact in South Sumatra. The one who benefit the most is the art and entertainment sectors. And we also see a very huge increase in transportation sector and broadcasting. The broadcasting, I think, this is due to the operational expenditures by the committee, by the INASGOG. Again, the utilities and construction is due to the investment done by the government. We also see this this event create many jobs for Jakarta and also South Sumatra. More than 50,000 jobs were created in the process of this event, from the pre-event until the during the event. So the national impact, we estimate that economic growth increased by 0.05 percentage point and create 22.3 trillion from 4 or 5 years. Especially for 2018 is around 8.2 trillion. So the last one, so we did a very simple projection, post-event projection of tourist arrival. So basically we benchmark what happened in Sydney Olympics. So we kind of make a scenario, if the same thing happened to Asian Games, post-Asian Games, how many additional tourists that we can get. So based on these simple calculations, we get like around 1.1% additional tourists per year. And then we put this as a shock to the CG model. And then we can see that using this simple scenario, the post-Asian Games will give a positive impact in the long term that coming from the increased tourism post-Asian Games. So for the conclusions, ladies and gentlemen, I think hosting a mega sport event such as Asian Games is an effective tool to create a new economic base in the short term. We see a higher GDP, higher GRDP increase in that due to increase in direct expenditure from construction, investment, operational expenditure, and also visitor expenditure. Right. We also see that it will benefit, the benefit also comes that also comes from the country image that can positively affect in the long term. So the economic of mega sport event can be more meaningful and optimal if the government can optimize the works with the stakeholders since several years before the event. I think this is one of the recommendations that come from our study. And then we found that sector that experienced the biggest increase from implementation of the 18 Asian Games is art and entertainment. So, I think this is echoing what have been presented by Revindo, that the Asian Games actually give positive impact to the Indonesian economy. I think I just want to close this with one note. I think we are quite lucky actually in during the 18 Asian Games, since we didn't really have to build new sports venue. So the investment that there is spent by the government is not that huge, so that's why the cost is not really that big, and then therefore the net benefit of this Asian Games actually a positive. I don't know if the case will be different if we decide, for example, to hold like Olympic events where we have to build a new sport venue, and then maybe we need to build a lot of new accommodation, for example. I think that will be a different case in the 18 Asian Games. I think that's all from me. Thank you. If you have any questions or comments, please free to do so. Thank you, Buini. I'll give the floor back to you.
Thank you. Thank you, Pak Firman, for the very interesting presentation. And then the interesting part of this study is actually the study not only looking at the event, the impact during the event, but this study also look at the impact of the economic impact before the event held, which is we call it the pre-event phase, and also the post-event phase. And also, and Pak Firman also mentioned very clearly that the long-term effect of these Asian Games will happen actually by increasing the number of visitors or tourism to Indonesia annually about 210,000, ya Pak Firman, for the annual increase in tourist visitors. And we also have Bu Berta here. Bu Berta, how are you? Bu Berta is also one of the author of this paper. And now we are entering to the discussion session. I will open the discussion if there is anyone would like to raise any questions or comments. And now I have three questions already, Pak Firman. And I think I'll stop until three questions only. The first question is regarding to how is the favorable economic impact to the public expenditure of the Indonesia in order to host, is it comparable to the spending of Indonesian government to support or to facilitate the preparation or the event itself? The second question, Pak Firman, is how to calculate the social and economic analysis impact of Asian Games. And the last one, did the researcher calculate the impact of each province outside Jakarta and South Sumatra? And what is the mechanism for looking at this impact? And I'll give the floor to Pak Firman and Bu Berta.
Okay, thank you, Ibu. So for the question, for the first question, how's the favorable economic impact to the public expenditure of Indonesia? Is it comparable? So basically, in our study, so we combine the benefit and also the cost. So when the in the mechanism in the model, so when the government increase their expenditure, increase their spending in Jakarta and also in South Sumatra. Also, for example, if the household increase their spending due to the Asian Games, so they will reduce their other spending. For example, the household will reduce their other spending, or they will take their saving. And for the government spending, if we increase the spending in Jakarta and South Sumatra, automatically the other spending in other provinces will be decreased. So in the model, I think we already include we already combined the benefit and the cost of the model and then of the event, and we show that the net benefit is actually still positive. I think that's for the first question. And how to calculate the social and economic analysis impact of Asian Games? So I think in this study we use a CGO model where we calculate the direct impact of the model, and then we put the direct impact as shock to the model to see the wide economic impact, not only to the province of Jakarta and South Sumatra, but also to the national level. So not only we measure the GDP for the economic indicators, but we also measure the impact on the employment. This is already built in the CGO model. I think that's for the second questions. For the two questions, yes, we did. We calculate the impact of each provinces, outside Jakarta and South Sumatra. So as I mentioned, so we use multi-regional CGO model. So the model itself contains 34 provinces, not only Jakarta and South Sumatra, but we have all the provinces. So when we put a shock in Jakarta and when we put a shock in South Sumatra, we can see the impact to other provinces. So the mechanism for creating this impact, so basically the model has some kind of like economic interrelations between provinces, and that's how we can calculate the impact to other provinces. That's for me. Maybe Berta, you want to add answer for all the questions?
Maybe I'll just add a bit on the second question, but it's not about the CGE model per se, but because when we did the study before, we also had several other extension studies. And then there's also this, one of the extensions that we take a study case on one of the merchandise provider for the ASEAN Games. It is so for the merchandise of the ASEAN Games, it is provided by one of the social enterprise that actually empower women in the eastern part of Indonesia. So I would also like to mention this part that probably not included in the CG model, but we also did kind of qualitative analysis on the impact of ASEAN Games to the province of South Indonesia, where there's this women in Nusa Tenggara Timur, in East Nusa Tenggara, that actually were empowered from the ASEAN Games, because from this social enterprise, it's called Buanyam. They produce these weaving products, and they provide their products as the merchandise for ASEAN Games. And in fact, they empower more women in the eastern part of Indonesia. And then because of this empowerment, it also indirectly increased the income of women in this remote area of Indonesia. And then in fact, the long-term effect is also to help them to increase the education of their children and also the health of their children. So actually, I only want to add about this, like outside the CG model, we also conduct some analysis on the impact of this particular social enterprise, how they empower women in outside Java. That's all from me.
Yeah. Thank you very much, Pak Firman and Bu Berta, for a very fruitful discussion and presentation. And I'll stop there for Pak Firman and Bu Berta's session. And if the participants still have any further questions, you can reach Pak Firman and Bu Berta directly by email or by WhatsApp. Now we are going to go to the next paper. The next paper is titled Bank Credit Development, a Study of Macroprudential Effect. This paper will be presented by Sebastiana Vivindratin from University of Jember. Is Ibu Sebastiana already here?
Thank you.
Yeah, Ibu. So you only have 10 minutes to present, Ibu. So if you could present within 10 minutes or less, it will be appreciated. Yeah. I'll give the floor to you, Ibu.
Thank you, Bu Amalia Adininggar. Yeah. Good afternoon. This thing is IEA, World Congress presenter and participant. Let me introduce myself. My name is Sebastiana Vipindratin from Fakultas Ekonomi dan Bisnis Universitas Jember. Today, I would like to present about bank credit development, a study of macroprudential effect. PowerPoint? PPT? Yes. Macroprudential policy is a policy that leads to the analysis of the financial system as a whole, as a collection of financial individuals, including banking. Macroprudential policies can prevent and mitigate systemic risk, encourage more balance and quality intermediation function, and improve financial system efficiency and financial access. The financial system is a framework or system that facilitates saving and loan of fund or money, the function of bank intermediation. The stability of the financial system depends on the health of financial institution and financial market stability. The financial system has an important role in the economic, where the financial system can help reallocate resources, especially the funds, so that excessive funds from the excess funds can be utilized by the underfund parties. Banking is one of the economic sector within the framework of a very important financial system role in the economic development of Indonesia. Because economic growth will be faster with better banking role. The role of good banking can be seen from the efficiency of its banking. Efficiency is a performance parameter that theoretically underlies the entire performance of a company. Ability to produce maximum output with existing input. Banking efficiency is one of the indicators that can know and analyze the strength of a bank. With the identified input-output allocation, it can be further analyzed to see the cause of inefficiency. Systemic risk becomes an empirical debate in various studies conducted in developed and developing countries. Risk can be addressed using macroprudential policy instruments. A study conducted by Lim et al. 2011 argued that the increasing number of instruments used will be more effective in reducing the procyclicity and effectiveness of the shocks caused by the financial sector. The familiarity of macroprudential policy in Spain can help in overcoming the increasing credit losses during the global financial crisis. Next. Risk can be addressed using macroprudential policy instrument. A study conducted by Lim et al. Argued that the increasing number of instruments used will be more effective in reducing the procyclicity and effectiveness of the shock caused by the financial sector. A stable financial system will be able to allocate resources and absorb shocks that may prevent disruption to real sector activities and financial system. The rapid development of credit shows that the role of banks is very important in financing infrastructure in Indonesia, so that the availability of credit in the economy is highly dependent on banking behavior. The instability in the financial sector can be affected by internal or external shocks. Such instability can lead to credit, liquidity, market, and operational risk, so that macroprudential policies are used to limit the risk and cost that may arise from the instability of the financial system. First, the effect of shocks from credit variables, exchange rates, ROA, LDR, CAR, and interest rates can be seen through impulse response function, IRF, in VAR model analysis.
Sebastiana, you only have 3 minutes left. Yes. Sorry for that.
Two, credit on ROA shocks appear stable and vice versa. The ROA respond to credit shocks in stable, meaning that both credit and ROA are equally influential. This study is in line with the theory where ROA is an indicator that indicates that if ROA increased, then bank asset has been used optimally to gain profit, so that ROA and credit have a positive relationship. LDR respond to stable credit shocks as well as, on the contrary, credit respond to LDR is stable in Indonesia, indicating that both LDR and credit have a big influence. This study concurs with the research of Juliana, which shows that LDR has a significant effect of lending. Macroprudential policy by using LDR instrument is very influential to the development of credit in Indonesia, where the higher LDR in a bank hence credit ability, which has been can channel by banking, also higher. This is indicated by the development of LDR period.
Two minutes, Ibu.
Conclusion. Based on the result of the analysis using FAR method on the effect of exchange rates, ROA, LDR, CAR, and interest rate on credit, it can be concluded as follows. One, exchange rate have a significant effect, both positive and negative on credit. This indicates that if there is a change in the exchange rate, will affect the development of credit in Indonesia. Two, ROA has a significant influence, both positive and negative to credit. It indicates that if there is a change to the ROA, it will affect the development of credit in Indonesia. Three, LDR has a significant influence, both positive and negative on credit. It indicates that if there is a change to LDR, it will affect to the development of credit in Indonesia. Four, CAR has a significant effect, both positive and negative on credit. It indicates that if there is a change to the CAR, it will be effect to the development of credit in Indonesia. Five, interest rate have a significant effect, both positive and negative on credit. This indicates that if there is a change in interest rate, it will affect the development of credit in Indonesia. Thank you.
Thank you, Bu. So now I would like to open the floor for questions. I haven't seen any question yet posted in the question and answer panel. Any other question? I'll wait for 30 seconds for any question that you would like to raise to the third presenter. If there is no question, Ibu Sebastiana, thank you very much, Ibu. There is no question actually that is posted. Again, it is a very interesting presentation. And thank you very much, Ibu Sebastiana. And I would like to proceed to the last paper, but last not least. The fourth paper is titled Special Capital Roles in Maintaining Investment Sustainability in Lumajang Regency. That will be presented by Ibu Sylvie Asna Prestianawati. She's from Faculty of Economics and Business from University Brawijaya. I'll give the floor to you, Ibu Sylvie.
Thank you, Bu Amalia.
You only have 10 minutes, please, Ibu.
Sure.
Yeah.
Okay, please for the committee to help me to open the share screen for my PowerPoint. Okay, good afternoon, distinguished ladies and gentlemen. It's an honor for me actually to meet all of you and have a fruitful discussion for the better hope for world improvement. And I am Sylvie from Universitas Brawijaya. I'm going to present about social capital strengthening strategy for maintaining investment sustainability in Lumajang Regency. Next. Next. Actually, as explained by Mankiw in his book in Principle of Economics, the capital stock is a determinant of economic output that has an important role because of change in capital can change over time, and this change can affect economic growth. And the capital stock itself is affected by investment and depreciation. And also in his book, The End of Poverty, states that investment can stop the poverty trap. This investment in itself can increase human capital, which is able to make economy more productive to meet basic human needs. And it is very clear that investment itself has a close relationship with GDP or the level of the people welfare. High and effective investment will certainly increase GDP, including the community welfare. And also some researchers also state that the long-lived company or long-lived investment is not only capable of managing tangible assets like land, employees, and capital, but also managing intangible assets like a people and culture itself in their environment, so that it can become a successful survivor, which does not make the company as an economic animal, but also working on, but also taking right of the society too. Next. Furthermore, this object research actually take place in small area in East Java, that is Lumajang Regency. Lumajang Regency actually my hometown, and Lumajang Regency has abundant resources that is sand mining. Lumajang itself has around 60,000 hectares of sand mining area spread in various parts of Lumajang, and its quality of sand itself produced is also referred to as the number one quality in Indonesia. Besides building, Lumajang also has iron sand containing iron ranging from 40% to 60%. And then the abundance of sand come from volcanology of our mountain, that is Semeru Mountain. Semeru Mountain is the highest mountain in Java, which is contain soil or other soil materials, which is very low, which only 3%. The volume of sand produced by Mount Semeru reaches around 1 million cubic hectares per year annually. Suppose that one cubic meter is valued 150,000 rupiahs, then the real potential that Lumajang Regency should get is around 150 billion per year. Lumajang sand actually can be used for all development needs at the national level, such as concentrate in manufacturing, toll roads, building, and so on. This sand must be mined, since in addition to be economically profitable, and it can also prevent major floods when the rainy season comes. So if we check on the showed paragraph, it proved that this resource not invested well, because see, every year we have the sand mining, the investment in sand mining is going decrease. Okay, next. Next slide, please. Okay, thank you. Previous slide, please. So here, the inflation and economic growth rate in Lumajang, it's not affected very well. So we can see here that the graph, the inflation and also the economic growth is not well, it's not well growth. And it impacted because of the low investment in sand mining as the main resource in Lumajang. Please, next. And here the poverty rate, it also affect to poverty rate in Lumajang is still 98%. So can we imagine if we have one area and we have the abundant resource like sand mining, it will be so rich. But in Lumajang, the thing different happened. Okay, next. So that's why the question of this research is why Lumajang is still poor, and what factor affect Lumajang's investment actually. Okay, next. And okay, the methodology, next. We use a qualitative research method with phenomenology.
3 minutes. Sorry for that.
With phenomenology approach. So next. So yeah, okay. Findings, please. So Lumajang, as the famous area that has very high sand mining quality, should has high investment rate on sand mining. But the fact Lumajang is not one of conditions to attract the investor is security. Lumajang also famous as the top city that makes some investor worthy to come or to invest. All of our informants state that because of those criminality, they must pay more, such as once investor just come to have sand mining business and they has the legal permission, they still must pay as they call social fee as social permission. If not, they will not able to run their business safely, such as many tax to come, theft, murder, destruction of operational equipment, and etc. It will higher the transaction cost rather than the production cost itself. And second is, what affect the investment level in sand mining? As the theory said, the investment affected by three factors that are interest rate, increased economic activity, and technology advance. But in Lumajang, we found that we have to add one more variables, that is social capital. Social capital itself are as the appearance of social organization, such as belief, norm, and network that can improve the efficiency of society by facilitating or cooperating for mutual benefit. As theory state that more social capital is generating economic resources and emphasize the cooperative relationship that establish democracy between people to people. And next, here we found that there are two kind of social capital implemented in Lumajang. First is personal branding strategy. Personal branding strategy implemented by middle and low investor for constructing their self-social capital in order to maintain their sustainability of their investment. Constructing social capital usually through two people or more to achieve the objective. And this strategy also cannot be delegated. Need a commitment and also passion and multi-talent investor to achieve people trust and empathy. PBS also creates as an angel branding for the investor, as the angel branding figure in the middle of the environment who able to help everyone and understand their needs. This strategy will be expensive at the beginning, but it will be cheaper and able to sustain the existence of the social capital in the long term. And then the medium investor has been running. One of our informant, he is Iqbal, that his business is an individual business, and currently he has 5 mining areas. Its areas is located right in the middle of the local community, and some are local of the edge of the village. And so such effect as the sound of the truck carrying the sand, disturbing the people actually, and a lot of dust can affect the people's health. So Iqbal is required to be able to minimize the advanced effect of his business and make people around the location feel safe. So Iqbal, what Iqbal do to create the social capital? So Iqbal's care to the community become his strength actually, which make people feel uncomfortable to comfortable about his business. Implicitly, the local people actually have. Okay, but they actually would like to talk about it over the impact of Iqbal business actually. So the informant is not only giving money and chicken monthly to the community, but also he give rice, school, and also water. Similar to his treatment to worker, his business strategy does not only affect his business, but also welfare. It also affect the welfare of the worker and the comfortable of the worker itself, which create high confidence of both the worker and the community. And it is proven that the social capital facilitates his business activity. And next, please, about the self-esteem approach strategy. Okay, so self-esteem approach strategy actually is step taken by environment to maintain the sustainability of its investment through expertise and power. So in general, getting close to people through good communication and helping people are the way to construct social capital. But contrary, thing happened in Lumajang, this informant, it's Subardi Wijaya, is the big investor in sand mining in Lumajang, make the distance with the people to achieve social capital. It is interesting actually because based on him, that it is important because of the people character reason. Most of Lumajang people are from Madura ethnic who have like stubborn trait. So he believed that through this stand and empathy will implicated stimulate sustainability cooperation, and they will respect and trust him. Then he will able to control the community and then he will able to easy her business without any community or people problem. So usually in terms of the social capital, so it will be conclude that social capital as well as the self-esteem social capital or self-branding itself, it should be able to increase the sustainability of the investment in Lumajang Regency as the implication of the heteroculture people. So it will be more cheap and also it will more sustain and give more impact for the people. So success usually comes to those who are too busy to be looking for it. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you for the very nice findings of this paper. You mentioned very clearly that it needs a new strategy, ya Bu ya, for Lumajang to be able to have a sustainable investment in that region. And I think your strategy that is offered in this paper is very much well defined, and we hope that it can be implemented as an input to Lumajang Regency. Now I have now one question that will be conveyed to you, Ibu. The question is that what is meant by the poverty rate above 100%? And the other question is that why in 2015 there is a significant growth of 1,715% for the industry?
Thank you.
I'll give the floor to you.
Yeah, thank you, Bu Amalia. So actually the poverty rate I got from the BPS, that it's a difference between the target and the fact. So for example, the target is 100%, for example, it's less or more than the target. So in 2015, actually Lumajang has the very bad or yes, the worst cases, because in 2015, all Indonesia know about the Salim Kancil or the murder about the sand mining case. So there is a people in who working in sand mining and to be killed by another one just because of the competition, and so all the sand mining areas were closed in that time, and all the operational about the sand mining was closed, and no income for the people, and also you know. Most of our people in Lumajang are live in sand mining, and because they also working as the traditional sand miner. So once all closed, so and it's closed around 1 year, it's too long. So it's affect to the poverty itself. But I'm sure that the poverty is not only affected by the sand mining problem, but also any other factors like the education and also the low quality of our infrastructure in Lumajang.
Yeah, so you highlighted again that social capital is actually the key for the success of Lumajang Regency to invite more investment, right?
And maybe it could be implemented in the area in the same characteristic like Lumajang people.
Right. So one last question, Ibu Sylvie, is that social capital strategy is equal to social communication plus social cost? And will there be, is it similar to CSR?
CSR is part of our, is a way actually to reach the social capital. But actually social capital is not equal to CSR. CSR is just small part of social capital. Social capital is more huge effort. It's like a glue, how to connect people to people and how we do the ethics in business, how we give our good intention to the people so they will convert to our business and they will not disturb our business anymore.
Yeah, and social capital is in the broader term, right? And it's actually, it's a capital. It's not only the CSR or not only the money, but there is a value with that, right?
Yeah.
The value that will be attached to the social, the society, so it can be like a capital for the society to grow better.
Sure.
Yeah. Okay. I think there is no more question, Bu Sylvie, and if because there is no more question, I would like to end the session. And again, I would like to thank to the whole presenters for the session, Pak Revindo, Pak Firman, and Ibu Berta, Ibu Sebastiana, and Ibu Sylvie. And we hope that the presentation will be very much valuable to all participants. And again, if you still have further questions to the presenters, and I'll offer all participants to reach the presenters. I'd like to end by saying thank you very much for everyone, and have a very good day. Thank you.
Catch you later. Thank you, Bu Winnie.
Yeah, thank you. Terima kasih semuanya, Pak Revindo, Pak Firman, Bu Berta, Bu Sylvie.
Izin eksilnya.
Sampai ketemu lagi, Pak Revindo ya.